those of you who are on live stream, Facebook, YouTube, whatever your platform, we welcome you in the service of the Lord this morning. So we're going straight into the word this morning. If you would turn with me in your Bibles to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 10. You're going to hold that there for a while. Paul, the apostle of Jesus Christ, writing in his second letter to Timothy and to us by extension, because it is the word of God, he says in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, "Thou therefore," still getting a little ring down here, "Thou therefore endure hardness as good soldiers of Jesus Christ." Do you see that on the board? "Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." I could stay right there and preach a whole message on it. But that's not the message this morning. But just so that you'd know that Christianity is not pie in the sky until you die, we are going to endure hardness. And we must recognize that from the onset. The next verse tells us, verse 4, "No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." Now I have asked for that text to remain on the board for a while, because we want to look into it a little bit more. But before I do this, let me say that it is sad to say a large percentage of the Church of Jesus Christ today operates totally oblivious of the four truths contained in these words. And I'm going to enumerate them. One, that as children of God, we are to be good soldiers. We are to be good soldiers of Jesus Christ. That as good soldiers, we are to endure hardness. I know we don't like it, but the Bible says we have to endure it. And God knew that there would be hardness in our life. That's why he inspired the word. Three, we are to war. Do you see that in verse 4? Yes. "No man that warreth." We are to war. And as a result, we are not to entangle ourselves with the affairs of this life. That's also in verse 4. Meaning that we are not to be so wrapped up with the affairs of this life that we do not have time for the things of God. Are you with me this morning? 4. Our lives must be lived to please God, not to please ourselves. I think I saw some words to the effect on the board this morning. Our life is his. Our lives must be lived to please God, who has chosen us to be soldiers. 4 underlying truths that are oblivious to many a Christian today. Why? You can take it off the board now. We have today within the church world what leaders, or rather leaders who are more interested in titles of themselves, feeding what makes the congregation feel good rather than what the congregation need. All over the world, the church world, that is happening. I came in here on Friday night, and I was told that I should congratulate a young man who was just made to be an apostle. I wonder who made him to be an apostle. You see, people are more interested in titles rather than doing what God says. Not understanding that the title is not something you hold on to. It is only to identify you as to what you should be doing. And if you are not doing the work of a prophet, you are not a prophet. If you are not an apostle, you are not an apostle. We call them apostles, but as Jesus says, they are not. As a result, the congregation live an airy, fiery kind of Christian life, believing that God owes them everything, and all they have to do is to name it and claim it, and they would have it. Ultimately, there is a lot of disappointment among such believers who eventually fall prey to the devil. The truth of the matter is that as children of God, we are engaged in a warfare. Now, I don't have to tell you this again. We have heard it over and over. We have preached about it. We have led you into warfare here in the congregation, but I must remind us at all times. It must be there all times. We are not just called to be saved and wait and die and go to heaven. We are called to a warfare because we have an enemy. We have an adversary that is determined. Since he can't keep us from coming to Jesus, he will keep us from growing in him. And as long as we are not growing in Christ, we are going to be living a defeated Christian life. So the truth of the matter is that as children of God, we are engaged in a warfare, and that Christianity is not pie in the sky till you die. We are going to have problems of many kinds. We are going to have situations in our lives, negative situations. We already have them. I'm only saying what has to be. I can't tell you that it's not going to be so because God's word says in this world you will have what? Tribulation. But we have got a blessed hope. He says, but be of good cheer in the midst of the tribulation. We can be of good cheer. Why? Because he has overcome the world. And if we are in him, then we too are guaranteed to overcome the world. So there is no ifs, buts, or doubt about it. We are in a warfare. Ephesians 6, 11, 12 tells us emphatically that we are to put on the whole armor of God. Why? That we may be able to stand against the wiles, the cunning craftiness, the manipulation of our adversary, the devil. Verse 12, for we wrestle not against what? Flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of darkness of this earth, spiritual wickedness in high places. These are high-ranking demons or emissaries of Satan that are over every country of the world who control lesser-ranking demons to do the bidding of Satan against our lives and the people of the world. If we take a look at what's happening in the world today, more specifically, the United States of America, are you seeing what's happening there with the LGBTQZ? And they have gone a step further. They are now indoctrinating our little children in schools. Little children. Cause them to believe that they are neither male nor female as yet. When they get big, they can determine what they want to be. Hogwash! This is what we are facing in the world today. And don't think it's going to remain in Trinidad. It's going to come here as well. Because when America blow their snotty nose, the whole world is contaminated. So it's going to happen here. And who is responsible for it? Oh, there is no such thing as the devil. There is no such thing as the devil. Well, who is responsible for all the evils that are in the world today? And look at our position as Christians. And when I say Christians, not those who call themselves Christians, but who are truly Christians. How are you truly a Christian? When you are born of the Spirit of Christ. Not born into a religion that calls itself a Christian religion. When you are born into Christ, when the Spirit of Christ comes into you and you are born of the Spirit of Christ, then you are a Christian. Otherwise, you call yourself a Christian, but you are not. So that as Christians, we are living in a world that is controlled by Satan. Don't think that God is controlling the world. We should not think so. Because if God was controlling the world, it would not be an evil world that it is. The Bible tells us in Corinthians that Satan is the god of this world. And that's understandable when we look around and see all that's happening in the world today. Why do we have so many murders in Trinidad? Why is there so much corruption? Is that of God? Is God controlling Trinidad? Definitely not. He's not. I mean, he is in overall control, and evidently, he will have his way. But in the meantime, he allows Satan to have his way, make his play, so that he, God, would be able to take out of the kingdom of darkness, which is this world, take out of that kingdom and bring whom wills into his kingdom, the kingdom of God here upon earth. In the midst of all the adversity and evil, God is building his church. He's building up a people that will serve him, that will worship him, that will glorify him, that will be obedient to him. And we cannot be such a good people until he puts his spirit in us. Otherwise, we are lost. No matter how goody two shoes we may be, the Bible tells us all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. And until God puts his righteousness in us, we are sinners of note on our way to hell. So those of us who have embraced Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord, we are born of his Spirit. We are now the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. But we are living in a world that's controlled by the devil. So that what I am saying is that these high-ranking demons or emissaries of Satan that are over every country of the world, who controls lesser ranking demons to do their bidding, the bidding of Satan against our lives, we have an adversary. And he has declared war. We are in a warfare. If that were not bad enough, if that were not bad enough, we have an internal enemy called the old man. Not by virtue of age, by virtue of nature. The sinful nature that we are born with is still in every one of us. And this is why God has to be always sending his word to direct us to live according to his word and not according to this sinful nature that is in us. That sinful nature in the human nature drives us to do the things that are wrong and contrary to the word of God. So we are fighting against the sinful nature, and we are fighting against the external nature, which is the devil. The sinful nature is where the propensity to gratify corrupt desires. We all have that propensity to gratify corrupt desires that are enhanced by the external forces of evil through temptation and the influence of our minds. I want us to remember those last two words, the influence of our minds, because that's where we are going this morning. The mind then becomes a battlefield of the devil, so to speak. Now, we have heard this before. We know this. But we have to keep bringing it to our fore, the fore of our minds. Otherwise, we can let it slip and fall prey to the very devil that we are supposed to be fighting against. The mind becomes a battlefield of the devil. We are fighting an external enemy in our minds, and we are fighting an internal enemy in ourselves, operating in our minds as well. To do that which is wrong in the eyes of God, while at the same time knowing what is the right thing to do. That's the position we are in. We know what is the right thing to do, but we are influenced to do the wrong things, and our sinful nature wants to do that wrong thing. So it's a real, real battle. It's a real battle that we are in. But we are not losers in this battle. We are not losers in the battle, no matter how bad it can be. Why? Because we have a commander in chief who have gone ahead of us and have established, secured the victory for us. All we have to do now is to live according to the war manual. And we are born to win when we are born again. Born to win. But we have to live. We have to live. We have to live according to the war manual. Otherwise, we would be defeated. So the mind is the battlefield of the devil. To do that which is wrong in the eyes of God, that's what he inspires, while at the same time knowing what is the right thing to do. And this is where the person, you, me, we have got to exercise choice. We, you, me, have got to exercise choice. The devil can't make us. And God won't do it for us. He tells us and he expects us to walk in obedience to his word. Romans 6:16 tells us, it is to whom we, ye feel ourselves servants to obey. The ones we yield ourselves servants to obey. To the one you obey is the one who masters you. To whom you yield yourselves servants to be, his servant you are to whom you obey, whether it be the devil or God, whether it be sin or righteousness. The choice is always ours. Yes, we have got a great helper, but he is not a dwight for us. He is a helper. He helps us, but we must make the choice. And every one of us who are doing things contrary to the word of God, it's because we have made that choice to do that which is contrary to the word of God. Don't blame anybody. Don't say anybody make you do it. Nobody could make you if you don't. God won't do it for you, and the devil can't make you. The choice is always ours. So this morning, I want to deal exclusively with the mind as a battlefield. The mind is the set of faculties responsible for all mental occurrences, which include thought, imagination, memory, will, and sensation. Do you want me to say that again? The mind is the set of faculties responsible for all mental occurrences, which include thought, imagination, memory, will, and sensation. This morning, we're going to be dealing exclusively with thought and imagination, because those are the two powerful areas that the enemy can use to defeat us in our Christian lives. It is said that who controls the mind controls the man. Don't know if you have ever heard about that before, but you're hearing it now. It is said, who controls the mind controls the man. In other words, you don't go anywhere unless your mind tells you to go that way. So we have to determine this morning who is controlling our minds. God doesn't control our minds. The devil seeks to control our minds, but we are the ones that must be in control of our minds. If we don't control our mind will control us. Are you with me this morning? You sure? And if we are not in control of our mind, the devil is going to occupy the driver's seat. And when he occupies the driver's seat, we should know where our destination would be. So we have got to do everything not to allow him to control our minds. When a way of thinking and or feeling has developed a life of its own in your mind, in our minds, by that I mean you don't even have to think it. It's always there. Morning, noon, and night. That thing is on your mind. If it is not a God thought or a God kind of thought, that is considered a stronghold of the devil in your mind. Such strongholds are usually formed when a thought becomes entrenched in the mind, either by your continuing thinking of it or by the devil's perpetual influence of it and you accommodating that thought. I'd give you some examples of strongholds. You're having bitter thoughts towards someone. They may have done you the worst possible thing in the world. But as a Christian, our Bible tells us we are to forgive. Not so? But if we hold on to that thing and we have this bitter feeling, this bitter thought towards the person of our mind, and we can't seem to shake it, that is a stronghold of the devil. We can have unforgiving thoughts. We can have resentful thoughts. We're praising God. We're praying to God, but we have resentment in our minds towards is somebody or is something. And let us make no mistake about it. Our adversary is going to make sure that there are going to be people that will come up against you to cause you to be resentful. Even people in the very church that you are may be saying things about you and doing things against you, and you hear about it, and you can develop that resentment in your mind, and you're carrying that resentment every day of your life. It becomes a stronghold. Are you with me this morning? Jealous thoughts. Thoughts of suspicion. Sexually lustful thoughts. Unclean thoughts. Even worrisome thoughts can be strongholds in our minds. Strongholds such as these are open doors for like spirits to oppress us. When we have got that stronghold in our mind, it's not a God thing. It's an ungodly thing. It becomes an open door for the demon of that manifestation to come into us and begin to control our lives in that respect. So that any other beside the stronghold is either a thought that we think or a thought that comes to our mind by way of remembering. Have you ever said, I just remember? So where was it all the time? Okay, I just remember. Or a thought by external influences, which is the devil. I think I told you this some time ago. I was in a drugstore, a pharmacy. And Jenny wanted some tablets for the dog to warm out. The pastor of Holiness Revival Ministries, who loves the Lord Jesus Christ beyond my understanding, who is willing to obey the Lord to the letter. I am standing in front of the compartment with the medication. I picked up one. The price on it is $8 and some change. And in my mind, I hear, thief it. Don't you imagine that? Do you see how dumb and stupid the devil is? But do you know he has to try? Because there are some people he will catch with it. Thief it. Me, the pastor, Holiness Revival. So the devil has access to our thoughts. And if you doubt it, then you are being a hypocrite. Because I'm sure you have had some devilish thoughts before. We all do. So when thoughts by external influences come to us that are not complementary to the ways of God, we should know who is the author and influencer of such thoughts. So what do we do about it? And that's what the message is about this morning. Another feature of the mind is that of imagination. Could you imagine that? That imagination is a feature of the mind. Simply put, that's when we are able to form a mental image of an idea or something that we desire. We can make it almost alive in our minds by imagining. Imaginations can be used to do things with our minds that we would like to do, but which we cannot otherwise do. So what we do is we sit down and we imagine the thing. As a young Christian, finding out that we are engaged in a warfare, I used to go, this is a confession. It's a confession, open confession. When I lie down in the night to sleep, I would begin to imagine that I am a soldier in camouflage and everything, with a machine gun in the hand. I'm a Marine, and I'm fighting in war, and I'm running through all the bush and climbing and shooting down it. And that's how I used to fall asleep. And it was so vivid in my mind, I could see myself in camouflage and with a machine gun. What I'm saying to us this morning is we can imagine anything and make it like real to us. And the devil knows the power of our imagination. And if we are not careful, he can put some things in our minds for us to imagine that will cause God to block his face and turn his back, so evil they could be. So in collaboration with our fallen nature, our adversary is capable of influencing imaginations of anything that is incompatible with what is right in the eyes of God. For instance, fantasy lust, or imagining sexual activity with a person who you would love to have sex with, but you can't. So you can bring that person. It may be a movie star from Hollywood. Bring that person right into your bedroom, on your bed, and commit fornication in your mind with that person. That's how powerful imagination is. And the devil knows it very well. And he uses it very, very well in Christendom. In Christendom. We may think lightly of it, but hear what Jesus says in Matthew 5, 28. I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her in his heart. So, brothers, we can commit adultery. We can commit fornication in our minds by imagining things that we want to do but cannot do. And Jesus said, whosoever look upon a woman, so he's talking about a man, but let us don't fool ourselves. Women can do it as well. So altogether, the mind as a battlefield is able to think thoughts, one, that are not of ourselves, but are influenced by demonic forces. That's the external war. Two, devilish thoughts that are of our own thinking by way of our fallen nature. That's the internal war of the mind. Three, devilish imaginations that we ourselves imagine, that we ourselves imagine because we have the capacity to imagine things. And if we choose to imagine devilish things, then devilish things will be our imagination. Or we are influenced by external enemy to imagine devilish things. I made sure to put it in that way for us to understand that it doesn't always have to be an influence of the devil. Yes, he's a master at it. But because of the fallen nature, this sinful nature in us, the old man who has the propensity to do evil, we ourselves can imagine things. As I told you how I used to imagine that I was a soldier fighting a war. I always wanted to be a soldier in God's army, so I used to practice it with my imagination. So we see three areas that the devil can take hold of our minds with imagination. I'm going to run by that one more time. One, the imagination is not of ourselves, but are influenced by demonic forces external to our minds. That's the external war. Two, devilish thoughts that are of our own thinking by way of the fallen nature. That's the internal war of the mind. And it doesn't necessarily have to be some out-of-the-world evil thoughts. Any thought, if you think something about someone that you should not be thinking, those are the thoughts that are internalized. They are internal thoughts. 3, devilish imaginations that we ourselves imagine or are influenced by external forces. This is the war of the mind. A war that, as children of God, we must listen to me this morning. Listen to the Spirit of the Lord this morning. A war that, as children of God, we must fight as good soldiers if we are to please Him who has called us, who has chosen us to be a soldier. That's why I use that text up front, for us to understand our calling. I want to say that again. We are the one who must make that decision to fight the good fight of faith as children of God, whom God has called to be chosen to be good soldiers. If we are to please Him who have chosen us to be a soldier, we cannot win the external war. Please take a note of that. We know we like to fight devils in the name of Jesus. Come out external. But if you are losing the internal war, you can't win the external war. We have to deal with ourselves first. Jesus said it another way. You know. He says, you can't have a beam, a 4x4 beam in your eye, and you want to go and pick out a little mote from somebody else's eye. We can't have ourselves full of evil thoughts and we want to rebuke Satan for putting thoughts. We have to deal with ourselves. We have to fight the internal war. Win the internal war. And then win the external war. Of course, we can't wait until we win completely the internal war. But if we have if we have made groundwork in one area, we could deal with that area. So that step by step, we can't do it all at once. Step by step, degree by degree, just as how the enemy works on us, we have got to work on him in our minds and in our lives. So I want to say again up front, we cannot win the external war until and unless we win the eternal internal war. Which brings us to our text this morning in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, and we are looking first at verse 3. Paul, in writing to the Corinthian church, who was belabored by people coming into the church and trying to undo what God had called Paul to do by bringing wrong, false doctrines and things like that. In context, that is what that text is about. And you know I like to keep things in context. But I'm using it now because the same thing applies to the battle for the mind. Paul is writing to the Corinthian church in chapter 10, verse 3, and he says, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. What in effect that means is, although we are living in the world, it is not a worldly warfare we are fighting. It's not a worldly warfare we are engaging. It's a spiritual war. So our weapons cannot be natural weapons. They have got to be spiritual weapons. That's what verse 3 says. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. And we saw in Ephesians 6:12 before that we are wrestling not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of darkness of this earth, spiritual wickedness in high places. We saw that. So the warfare that we are speaking about is a spiritual warfare where the mind is the battlefield. You win the war up here, and you are victorious. Continuing in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are what? Mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. So we spoke about strongholds before. I want to read it again with some emphasis. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're spiritual. But they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. So we must know the strongholds in our minds, and we are told that we are to do what? Pull them down. We can't afford to leave them there as strongholds. If you have been walking about disliking me for whatever reason and thinking evil of me or whatever you want to think, that's your business and God, not mine, then you have to do something about that stronghold. If you don't do something about whatever your stronghold is, it's going to hold on to you for the rest of your life because it's a stronghold. So you have to do something about it. And what does the Bible say? We are to do what? Pull them down. Don't leave them there in your mind. Pull them down. Pull them down. Pull them down. Pull them down. Don't leave them there. We do not have to entertain them. We do not have to let them control our minds. As children of God, we have the capacity. We have the power and the weapons of warfare to pull down strongholds in our minds, as well as casting down imaginations. Cast them down. That's what the Word of God says. Casting down imagination and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So you see where we have to take control of our minds. We have to take control of our minds. Otherwise, the devil is going to control us in the direction he wants us to go. And he's going to make sure that he puts things in our way. He's going to make sure he puts people in our way. Not necessarily or only people from outside. As I said to you, it could be people from the very church that you're in. It could be right there in your home, your husband, your wife, your children. To get you so that you will have thoughts in your mind that are not complementary to God. Right now, as I am preaching, he's putting thoughts of someone in someone's mind that they're at home asleep. So they're sleeping. So we have to cast down imagination and bring every thought, and high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, what we know to be right in the eyes of God, bringing them into captivity to the obedience of Christ. That is bringing all our thoughts into alignment with what will be pleasing to Christ. We have to have our thoughts in alignment. Our brother Anthony ministered to us very powerfully on the Holy Spirit last week. And he concluded by us being filled with the Holy Spirit. And I give a little demonstration of how we are to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We cannot have our life, our minds full of the devil's thoughts, and at the same time we are filled with the Spirit of God. Contrawise. Can't work. Can't work. Bringing them into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Those thoughts, bringing them into captivity to the obedience of Christ. That is, bringing all our thoughts into alignment with what will be pleasing to Christ, as Christ will have us think, or having Christ-like thoughts. And it's our responsibility to do so. To do otherwise, we are fooling ourselves, because we would be doing what is contrary to the Word of God. Loved ones, we cannot let the devil have control of our minds. We cannot let the devil have a free pass to our minds if we are going to please him, Jesus, who hath chosen us to be good soldiers. If we allow that, then we have forgone our calling in this respect by God. We are not good soldiers. We have to fight the good fight of faith for our minds, keeping our minds in alignment with God and the things of God always. Now, don't think we can leave here as having heard this message this morning and go home and do that. Huh? It's an exercise. It's an exercise. If we have been living with something for our past life, it's not going to just go away because you hear a message. No, you have to apply. You have to be doers of the word and not just hearers. So we have to fight the good fight of faith for our minds. The things that the devil would have us think, and some of the things we ourselves think that will not be pleasing to God, we must be aware of it at all times, that God knows our every thought. Nothing is hid from him. God knows all our thoughts. We may be thinking things about people that are wrong. We may be saying things about people, and we say it because we think it. And we think that is okay with God because we come to church and we pay our tithes, if you do, and we sing songs of praise, but in our minds we have these things you're operating on the devil's terrain, not on God's. And sometime down the road, it's going to catch up with you in some way or the other. So we have to pull down these strongholds. We have to change our thinking, get it in alignment with the ways of God and not ourselves, because we have got a fallen nature, and that nature would have us think things about people or other things that will not be in alignment with the ways of God. God knows everything, even our thoughts. He's such an awesome God. Not only does he know our thoughts, and I know you could never conceptualize this because I can't, but I have to believe it because it is his word. If he is omniscient and knows all things, then he knows them before they happen. He knows them before they happen. So what I'm saying, in effect, is God knows what you will be thinking even before you think it. You want scripture for that? He says, before you call upon me, I will answer you. Before you call, I will answer. Because he knows you are going to call. Ecclesiastes 2:4 tells us, for God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Ecclesiastes 12:4, written by a man whom God gave wisdom more than anyone else had ever had wisdom. Although in his wisdom, he became a fool. The capacity and the power to pull down strongholds and to cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, is resident within every one of us who are born of the Spirit of God. Could I say that to us again? The capacity and the power to pull down strongholds and to cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, the capacity and power to do so is resident within us who are born of the Spirit of God. Who is that? He is the Holy Spirit of God. Acts 1:8, but you shall receive power. Dunamis. Explosive power. Dynamite power. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. So we have the power. We have the capacity. All we need now is the willingness to do it. All we need is the willingness to pull down the strongholds, get them out of our minds, bring every thought, whatever the thought is, if it is not compatible with God, bring it into captivity of Christ. Let Christ reign in your thoughts rather than those thoughts in your mind. Bringing them into captivity. So we have the power and we have the capacity, as well as the weapons of our warfare that we are told are not carnal, they are spiritual weapons. They are spiritual weapons, and I want to emphasize that they are mighty through God to pull down strongholds, cast down imaginations, and to bring into captivity everything that the devil puts into our minds, or every devilish thing that we want to think. Understanding that having a weapon and not using it is as good as not having it at all. And this is what we are here for this morning, to understand the battlefield of the mind, how the enemy can have access to our mind, how he can cause us to think things. He can cause us to imagine things. We ourselves can think things out of our fallen nature. We can imagine things out of our fallen nature. But if they are not in alignment with God, we need to do something about it, as we are hearing this morning. The Word of God doesn't come to us for us to analyze how pastor preach, how much green verb he used, how much spittle fly out his mouth when he was preaching. All them things people just look at. It is to hear the Word of God, realize that you're not hearing it as coming from man, but as from the Spirit of God. Apply it to our lives and begin to live. Begin to live. Begin to live the thing that God has sent. God is not speaking by guess. He knows we need to hear this word this morning. How many of you need to hear this word this morning? You think I lie down and dreamed that last night? Come on. So, understanding that having a weapon and not using it is as good as not having it at all. In the next 5 minutes, let me give you some of these weapons. First and foremost, Ephesians 6:17 tells us what? That the sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. Do you see that there? The sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. Every temptation that the devil put into the mind of Christ in the wilderness after he was baptized, Jesus used the sword of the Word. It is written. It is written. And this is what we have got to understand. It's one of the weapons of our warfare, the Word of God. If God says to do it, and the devil entices us to do otherwise, it is written. We are going to do the Word of God, regardless. If I were you down there, I would have clapped me. Well, not really clap me. I don't need clap. I don't need approval of anything when I stand behind you. But you would agree with the Word of God. As children of God, refusing to harbor or entertain any thoughts, anything that is pleasing to God is a weapon of your warfare. Refusing to do the bidding of the devil or the fallen nature. Refusing. That's a weapon of warfare. The name of Jesus in rebuking thoughts is a mighty weapon. We can't stop the thoughts from coming, but we could rebuke them in the name of Jesus. We do not have to entertain them. We do not have to follow them. We could rebuke them in the name of Jesus. And even thoughts must bow down to the name of Jesus, because that's the word of God. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So even your thought, the devil's thought, or your own thinking, has to bow to the name of Jesus. Obedience to God is a spiritual weapon of our warfare. Obedience to God, obedience to His word, it's a spiritual weapon. When the devil wants us to do something contrary to the word, we choose to obey the word of God regardless of consequences. A life of righteousness is a weapon of warfare. How so? Because if we are living a righteous life, we will not be doing any unrighteous thing. It's either righteous or it's wrongous. You do the righteous thing. So a life of righteousness is a weapon of warfare. Maintaining a good prayer life is a weapon of warfare. Unless we are hypocrites, we could not earnestly be praying to God and harboring thoughts of bad thoughts in our minds. Now, I'm not saying the devil can't put a bad thought in your mind while you're praying, you know. Listen to me. This thing will happen to you. Huh? I know that. Because I'm bad. It will happen to me. But I could be praying and a cuss word will pass through my mind. No, I don't cuss. Not again. I used to cuss real bad. But the devil has a way of bringing back things. You're praying, and a cuss word passed through your mind. You didn't think it. It passed. You don't stop praying and start cussing. No, you don't entertain the thought. God is not going to hold you responsible for that thought. But if it keeps happening, I would want to stop praying and deal with that thought. Listen to me. He's fierce, you know. He's fierce, you know. He will do anything to get between yourself and God. He's fierce. Okay, my time is up, so let me give you a finally, you know. Finally. Philippians 4:8, and it begins with the word finally. Finally, who? Brethren, you, me, everyone in Christ Jesus. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, do what? Think on these things. God has even told us how we ought to think. So when a contrary thought comes to your mind, you know it is not God. And if it is not God, is you thinking it? I am the one who would be thinking it? Or it is of the devil? Could I read that to you again? Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. God bless you richly this morning. I truly hope that that is not just a song that we sang, but that we have really made up our minds to serve the Lord in the way that He would have us serve Him.
At the inception of the service, I indicated that I would like to see the hands of those of you who are here for the first time. It is quite possible that first-timers are just visiting with really no interest, either belonging to another church or just not having any interest in serving the Lord. That's possible. The world is full with such people. But if you're here this morning and you truly want to serve the Lord, be in a place where you can, and when I say a place, a spiritual position, where you can really pour your heart out to Him, worshiping Him, recognizing that He has your life's breath in His hand, that He is the one who oversees your life. Yet you do not know Him in a personal way as your Lord and your Savior. You see, He is Lord. There is no doubt about it. The question is He your Lord? Have you ever given your life to Him? Calvary is an indication that He gave His life for you. But are you willing to exchange your life for His, where you can be born of His Spirit and truly be a child of God? You see, when we are born into this world, we are born separated from God because of sin. The Bible tells us, by one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. It's Romans 5:12, Romans 3:10. There is none righteous, no, not one. All have sinned. So if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're not belonging to God. You're a creation of God that has been lost through sin. Jesus Christ came to redeem you back to God the Father. If you don't receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're not one of His. That's what the Bible says. As many as receive Him, to them, John 1:12, to them He gives the power to become the Spirit of God, the children of God. That's when He puts His Spirit in you, and now you are born of the Spirit of God. And don't think it's happening in this church. It's happening all over the world among the people who will give their lives to Him. So if you're here this morning, I said all that I had to say to you. If you are not born of the Spirit of God, you need to be so born if you're going to belong to God. If God is truly going to be your Father in the spiritual sense. So I'm going to help you as I have been helped, and most of us here and millions around the world, we want to help you to come into that place. And it takes only a prayer. Only a prayer. And if you would like to be in that place where you are a child of God by being born of the Spirit of God, just raise your hand if you are not so already, and I will help you with that prayer. Is there one? Is there one? Is there one? Okay. Two things may have happened here this morning. Either we are all born of the Spirit of God, or one or two or three or four or five or however are not, and you have just refused to accept Jesus Christ as Savior, because a non-acceptance is a refusal. You're in a bad place. You're in a dangerous place. And I pray to all God that He will have mercy upon your soul, and you will have another opportunity to make it right with God. God bless you richly. You may be seated.